Good morning. Can you hear me? First lecture is essentially about communicating to all of you at some length the objective of this and the subsequent series of workshops. First of all, I had circulated an earlier version of a theme paper which I had written. I hope all of you have read that. Anybody who hasn't had access to it, because we originally sent it only to the heads of the institutions, but subsequently I think my staff would have sent it to all of you. So do you have any problem in reading, downloading and reading that theme paper? What I wanted to know primarily is, do you agree with most of the observations that have been made there? Because if you look at the problems that we face, I would just like to enunciate some of the problems once again, just to reiterate the issues. First of all, the technology that I am using is a mundane technology. It's a whiteboard technology, except that the board is somewhere else and whatever we write can be recorded. Subsequent lectures, we shall be using slides, as most of you do. So, I'll start with the problems in what I call educational quality. Has it really suffered? In a percentage sense, it has suffered, in the sense that because large number of students are learning engineering, the percentage of students who are well educated is falling. However, in absolute numbers, students who are getting well trained is increasing. Now, this is a dilemma which has not been captured even in my theme paper. So, let me start with this problem of scale, which is exactly what bothers everyone. So, just to take our own area of activities, take computer science, electronics and IT for example. Till about 1980, 81, 82, there were no bachelor's programs in IT or computer science. These words were not known. M.Tech programs used to run, master's program used to run. Electronics was by and large the closest thing to computers then. And there were roughly 5,000 seats for students annually across the country for admission to electronics program, counting all IITs, NITs and other institutions, just 5,000 seats, because the total number of colleges themselves were very few. From that, we have a total of 6 lakh students taking admission to engineering programs every year now, and almost half of them and slightly more take admission to bachelor's programs in IT, computer science and electronics and MCA, huge numbers. Okay. I had a big argument with NASSCOM leadership 2 years ago when they published a report, most of you would be familiar with that, that not more than 20 or 25% of our engineering graduates are employable. And I said, yes, I agree with you, but you are talking about 25% of what? At that time, we were producing something like 1 lakh students every year, out of which 50,000 students were in what you call ICT areas. And I have merely observed that 25% of 50,000 students is far more than 5,000 students that we ever produced in electronics. So, even if we assume that all 5,000 students were great, which was not the case by any measure, the country is still producing larger number of better students. Now, while that might answer a issue that whether are we giving quality education, the answer, real answer is yes, we are able to give quality education to some, but we are not able to give quality education to others. And the fundamental problem is that of scale. Unfortunately, most of us in institutions that are represented here, IITs, NITs, do not face that kind of problem to the greatest severity, although each one of us have problems of some kind or the other. There are other institutions which are participating here, but they are also well-known institutions, although they are outside the IIT and NITs, and they also face this problem to a lesser extent. What is the problem? First of all, the academic preparation of the students that come to our institutions, by and large, because they come through an extremely rigorous filtering process, you would agree that you would end up getting the best of the available students. Secondly, because these institutions have some reputation and have a reasonable amount of academic flexibility for the teachers, most of the people who want to join teaching as an academic professional career prefer to go to these institutions. But the scale is such that we have greater than 4,000 institutions today. In a AICT meeting 2 months ago, Dr. Mantha told me that we have 4,000 colleges approved as of now, and there are 2,000 pending applications for new colleges. Okay. 1 million people are vying to get into the professional education. The number of teachers that I would not say we have, but we need, are more than 1,50,000. Now that is the scale. Traditionally, if you see, us teachers were required to educate ourselves further, do some research, and then only get endorsed as teachers in the institution. So most of us would at least do a master's degree, and most of us would vie to complete a PhD as soon as possible. Now, you would know colleges in your own vicinity. How many colleges have teachers with PhD qualification? How many colleges have teachers with qualification of a master's degree? You will agree that the percentage is very small. And that is the first problem that we have, that we do not get teachers with the adequate academic background as we would like them to have. So, the associated, most of the problems come out of the scale problem, is the educational background of our teachers. The main problem is the educational background, which large majority of teachers having only a bachelor's degree, a first degree. This is a, by the way, this problem is going to become more acute even professionally for these teachers, because Mantha told me that in the, as per the sixth pay commission, the minimum qualification for a recognized teacher is at least a master's degree. And the nation just does not have adequate facilities, even if all the teachers wanted to do their master's. I mean, after all, if I join as a teacher, I might be a B, but I would aspire to do a master's. But on one hand, you give me N courses to teach, so no chutti, no nothing. On the other hand, you say you must acquire your master's degree, but I will not depute you to IIT Kharagpur or NIT Warangal or whatever, whatever. You do ME whichever way. Which way does a teacher do a master's degree? Now that is a major problem that is going to force us over the next 5 years. Slightly aside from the theme that we are discussing, I have proposed that the mechanism that we are going to use for these workshops be extended to provide subject teaching of courses at the master's level through distance education mode, and the project for the final year of the master's program to be done at the respective institution. So, create some kind of a virtual university environment where credits done for courses can be taken across universities, and that seems to be the only way where you can scale up that effort. But that's slightly aside. So, this is a problem. This problem is more acute in the areas of computer science, IT and electronics. So, again, I hope you will bear with me that if you see the colleges around your own institutions, the smaller colleges, while there will be a few people with PhD qualification, a few people with master's qualification, in areas like computer science, electronics and IT, you will have a larger number of teachers with a basic qualification of B. Is that correct? Is that observation correct? That is where we have the lack. There is an additional problem in the educational background, and this problem afflicts all of us. When I became a teacher, nobody educated me on how to teach. And I suppose that is true with all of you. So all of us have learnt how to teach by experience and by watching our seniors, by our colleagues. So it is like a peer education system and a self-education system. I find this ridiculous because at the school level, if you want to appoint a teacher, you insist that the teacher be well trained in teaching. So you have Bachelor of Education, Master of Education and so on. And yet I do not know of any institution which necessarily organizes a minimum 7-day orientation program for every new teacher who is appointed. IITs don't do that. I know for sure NITs don't do that. And I know for sure most of the other colleges don't do that. I go with a BE degree, with whatever qualification, if I am selected and appointed as a teacher in a college, the day I go and sign a joining letter or something like that, my head of the department says, here is this course, go and teach. Don't you find this ridiculous? What is the solution? The solution is to revamp the process from the bottom and say that no appointment of a teacher will be considered valid unless the teacher is given some initiation in teaching. Okay. The fact of life is that engineering people who teach engineering later are generally the smarter people amongst the educational mahal, and they have gone through the grading of an engineering course wherever, and therefore their analytical faculties have been reasonably sharpened, and therefore they can generally do a reasonably good job of teaching. But imagine if at the outset I was taught in the art of teaching, even for 7 days, preferably for a month, wouldn't I have been a better teacher right from day one, rather than evolving as one in later years? Why I mention this to you is that a large number of teachers that you will find in the engineering colleges are teachers with just 0 to 3 years of experience. And therefore, they desperately need some kind of initiation into teaching. So please keep that in mind when later on you go back and organize as coordinators the workshop for teachers in larger numbers. The third problem is the mindset of students. This is nothing new, but well established that students are primarily motivated by marks and grades. I do not know what it is at your institutions, but in IIT Bombay, whether it is a quiz paper or a test paper or a mid-sem paper or end-sem paper, the kind of arguments that students come with for half a mark, 1 mark, half an hour of argument, 1 hour of argument, saying no, 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 you give me less here, more there, etc., etc., tells you where their heart is. I don't know, you have similar experiences at your places also? Fine. Now, at institutions where we share the answer books and discuss the marking, etc., etc., these things happen. In university examinations, where there is no natural sharing of the answer book and people generally don't get a chance to get their question paper re-evaluated, the students know that in order to maximize the marks in the exam, they will have to study with a slightly different focus. So learning or knowledge gaining is not the primary focus of the students, but marks and grades is the primary focus. Can we blame them? After all, we select them in our institutions based on marks obtained in some examination. So whether it is JEE for IITs or whether it is IEEE or whatever examination systems, NITs, whatever, you would not admit somebody who is the lowest ranked person in that All India competitive exam, right? You will announce that person to be useless. So therefore, right from the childhood, the boy or the girl has been taught to maximize the score in exams. What happens after he or she comes to engineering college in our places, even in IITs and NITs? They know that during the placement season, the companies like IBM or HCL or TCS or whatever, Infosys, they will come and say 90% and above, top 5 students, top 10 students. Okay. So I know that if I am a laggard and if I score 40% marks or 50% marks, it is unlikely that any one of the good companies will even look at me. Okay. We all know that once you enter an organization, the marks and other things, they really do not count. How you work in that new environment and how you prove yourself is what is important. But marks are a door opener. And if marks are not there, the doors will not be opened. Therefore, the primary target is open the doors and therefore score marks. We call this exam-oriented mindset of the students. But I believe we cannot really blame students for it. We have no other mechanism to filter students that is accepted by the societal structure such as businesses and industry. That is where our students are going to go. So as long as the structures use this filtering, our students will work towards that. Does it mean that any learning that the student does is incidental? I call it incidental learning, that I am working for marks, but for scoring marks, I have to identify which are the important questions, I have to know the answers, and there will be some teacher who will put a question which is not exactly as per book or as per notes or as per guidebook. So I'll have to do some thinking. And since I am forced to do some thinking and some reading, I implicitly learn something. After all, what is learning? Learning is reading, thinking, articulating, discussing, again thinking. That is learning, right? So that learning happens perhaps incidental. Teachers, on the other hand, would like to ensure that the student's primary focus is on learning and scoring marks is incidental. There is a dichotomy and it is not likely to be resolved because there is no unique answer to this. We then talk of a few teachers who are able to hold the attention of the students, a few teachers who are able to make the students do work which is beyond whatever the call of duty, as you may call it, beyond syllabus and whatever. The mindset of student is also forced by another factor which again most of us in our institutions do not see, and that is straitjacketing syllabus. One is forced to teach as per printed syllabus because that is how exam papers are set. So there are universities which go to the extent of saying that this syllabus shall have the following 8 components. This component shall be taught for 4 hours, this shall be taught for 6 hours, this shall be taught for 5 hours. There shall be a question of 2 marks from this portion, 3 marks from this portion, 5 marks from this portion. I have not seen the more ridiculous example of quantifying the quality. After all, we teach a subject which is part of a larger body of the knowledge so that we enable the student to solve problems in that area. But problem solving does not remain a focus once the syllabus and question paper becomes the focus. Why again it is important for us to understand it? It took me also quite some time to appreciate this fact. But large majority of the 4,000 colleges are required to do this. You and I may like it or may not like it. I'll tell you another example. When we started distance education 10 years ago in IIT Bombay, in our school of IT, we started beaming our own courses, the way we teach them. And we thought people will implicitly like them. The students and faculty from most of the colleges said, "Sir, very good, nice knowledge, but it's useless. Our students are not interested. And therefore, we are not interested because we can't teach the way you teach." We started releasing edited contents of our audio-visual lectures, just like the MIT open courseware. We started releasing these contents in open source. People appreciated it, a lot of claps, a lot of downloads. But then we put in an experiment and measurement, how much of these contents are actually being used by people. Answer, big zero. So we asked, why? Are these lectures not good? Of course they are good. So why are you not using them? Sir, they don't address our syllabus. So you see, you cannot force the teachers to adopt the material that you release even in open source unless they perceive that material to be useful to them. And when will they perceive that material to be useful to them? If their students perceive that that material is useful. Does it mean that we reduce the level of our efforts in essentially preparing the digital equivalent of guidebooks? The answer is obviously no. We want the teachers and students of all the colleges to rise up, to the level of quality of education that all of us seek, even in our institutions. The dilemma is that if we start from the top, from where we are, which is what we try to do, we are never going to reach the bottom. However, we also don't want to land up to a level where we address the issues at the bottom, but never let them rise to the top. Consequently, the challenge before all of us is to engage these large number of teachers across the country, starting with whatever they perceive that they need, giving them that, and additionally saying that, look, most of our institutions additionally do this also. So please try this, please try this, please try this. And consequently, the extent of coverage that we do for any subject engaging teachers has to start with whatever that teacher perceives to be needed and end up with whatever is done at the best of the institutions, including ours and MIT's and Stanford and every place. That is a larger challenge. I just thought I will share that with you. But this all emanates from the mindset of the students, syllabus-oriented teaching and what I will call exam-oriented learning. A comment on the examination system. I myself did my undergraduate from a college in Indore, JSITS, and I was part of a university system where we were required to answer any 6 out of 10 questions. Most of the subjects will have section A, section B, whatever, whatever, but generally 6 out of 10 questions. I recall with great sense of amusement that in my first year, I studied very seriously the entire syllabus, scored very good marks, got a rank in the college in the first year students and so on. But then I discovered that most of the study that I had done was completely useless. In next year, hesitantly, I studied only 60% of the syllabus of 2 subjects. And I said, let's see what happens. I scored 89 and 85 marks in both the subjects, because you have to answer only 6 out of 10 questions. Then I perfected the technique. And by the time I graduated, I knew bare minimum of electrical engineering. Luckily, I knew control systems well, which I had studied for 100%, and that is how I could get admission to a master's program here. Don't you think that is what would be happening to many of our students who are bound by the university system? So the exam-oriented learning means that students are not interested even in covering up the entire syllabus that you are teaching. They feel it is not necessary, it is a waste of their time. This is the student's problem. There is a larger problem there. The larger problem is mindset of teachers. Here again, the problem comes out of the scale. At a time when we had about 70 to 80 engineering institutions in the country, IITs, NITs, and 2 or 3 engineering colleges per state, numbers were very small. Some of you are very young, you would not have seen those days, but some of my older colleagues would recall. Those days, the engineering program used to be a 5-year duration program. And the teachers that taught us in any engineering college typically had joined a teaching profession as a matter of choice. Whatever, whether they would have done PhD or not PhD, whatever, whatever, a large majority of teachers came to that profession by choice. Today, in absolute terms, there is still a larger number of people who are coming to teaching as a matter of choice, but as a percentage, the number is minusculely small. And once again, I will say, we don't see that in IITs, NITs, and some of the better colleges, but you go to the majority of 4,000 colleges, you will find that a large number of teachers have come to teaching as the second, third, or last option. Does it mean they will be bad teachers? No, not necessarily. But the desire to work towards a long-term career is probably not there. How do we address this issue? We address this issue by emphasizing that, look, it doesn't matter how long you stay in this field. After all, by the way, this is not true only about teaching. If you look at any other career building, all of your friends and all who are in the industry, whether in public sector, private sector, typically they would have joined the industry with a long-term career path in mind. So if you take even the IT industry today, most of the top leaders, whether it is TCS or HCL or Wipro or whatever, they have been there right from the inception, because they targeted a lifelong career or a very long-term career with the institutions in which they join. Even in the real world, young students who pass out from our colleges do not have a 10-year stint in an organization or a 15-year stint in mining and all. They are thinking in terms of 1 or 2 years, 3 years maybe. They want to switch a job. They switch a job because they will get better paid. Of course, they always say there is a better work there, but implicitly there is a better pay also associated with that better work. Whatever. No problem with that. But the mindset of teachers who come from the same ethos of the society is also becoming like. How do we then change that mindset? So I would like you to appreciate that one of the objectives of this engagement, because physically, those 1,000 teachers will not be coming to this place. Those 1,000 teachers will be coming, 30 people at your place, 35 people at your place, etc., etc. And as I will explain, we propose to run 12 such workshops in 12 different subjects. Why we have chosen subject as a center also I will mention. But given the fact that these 30, 35 teachers are going to be in your institution with you as the coordinator for about 15 days' time, I would like to request you to ensure that you actually spend a significant amount of time outside the academic contents of this course also. Because you will be in a unique position to influence to some extent their thought processes. And you will be the role model for them. So if they see, for example, that you are enjoying even coordinating this teacher's workshop, you are enjoying teaching, you are passionate about it, believe me, that will percolate down. And that is one of the objectives which is unstated and unwritten, but that is one of the objectives of this entire activity, namely to influence the mindset of the teacher. So I make a very simple statement to any teacher from any college. I say that I developed in 2001-2002. I took a 1 year sabbatical leave. I was worried about the quality of engineering education. So in that 1 year, I went around the country giving talks to students and teachers. I deliberately chose smaller places. I could not go to too many places, but I visited 67 colleges, interacted with students, interacted with teachers. And I found something very amazing. At every place without exception, I found some students who were as good as the students I find in NITs or IIT. Okay. As good. They may not be very polished in their English presentation or something. Usually I would interact with the final year students doing projects, and in smaller colleges students do projects in groups, 3 or 4 students together do a project. So when they are making a project presentation, group after group, and there will be large number of groups because there are 90, 120 students and so on. But you will agree that you would also be doing such evaluation, and during the evaluation you can easily spot a group which stands completely beyond anybody else. They have applied their mind, they have thought through the process, they have read, they can answer questions. The fact that they have thought independent, and mind you, they are not even getting the kind of guidance that they can get at better institutions. So in spite of that, they have done so. So I was very thrilled with this. I also found 1 or 2 teachers at every place who were different. I'll give you just one example. This happened in Orissa. Anybody from Orissa state here? Which is the Orissa NIT? There is nobody from Rourkela? Okay. Anyway, I went to a smaller place. This was a place near in a city called Behrampur. So this was a, by the way, this similar experience everywhere. I quote this experience because it's rather unique. So I was asking teachers after visiting the labs and all, aur kya karte? So one teacher sheepishly said that he runs a Sunday lab. He's an electronics teacher. I said, Sunday lab, what do you do in Sunday lab? In one particular semester, he runs a Sunday lab where they take up a large problem, they analyze that problem, they design a circuit, okay, They actually do everything from making PCBs and so on. It's one single problem they take. And together everybody will, the circuit means it's not a single PCB, but sort of a system or application or whatever. And at the end of the semester, they make that thing work. He runs the lab from on Sunday from 9 to 12. I was very excited. I said, do all students come? Nahi sir, sab nahi aate hain, 15-20 log aate hain. Out of a class of 60, if he is able to attract 15 students, you can imagine the greatness of the effort. I said, fantastic, because these 15 people will make a difference to the world. You are doing a great job. Then he says, sir, you are the first outsider or insider who is telling me I am doing something significant. My principal, of course, encourages me, but most of my colleagues say, pagal hai, syllabus chod ke bahar ka padhata hai. So you see now the attitude of a large majority of our teachers is also set by the mindset of the students, that it is useless to try and do anything outside the syllabus. Now one thing that we want to get across is, what is syllabus? Syllabus is a reflection of past knowledge which has been accumulated and which has to be minimally transmitted to the students. The syllabus in fact guarantees that no future problem is looked at. Whereas what we are preparing our students is to handle future problems. So first of all, there is very rarely a problem solving element. You look at what the teacher was doing. Actually, the teacher was emphasizing throughout the semester that the only objective in life is to solve this problem. Now you may have to slog for one semester to design, analyze, do whatever, whatever, whatever till we solve that problem. And believe me, there are teachers like that every place, even smaller colleges. But they will be in minority. One of the unwritten objectives of this entire effort is to try and percolate this ethos amongst the teachers. That yes, you will be bound by syllabus. Yes, students will look at examination. But does it prevent you from taking an initiative which will attempt to go beyond the syllabus, which will attempt to go beyond the exams? No matter how few students are interested, no matter how few faculty colleagues are interested, try something like that. So I've been suggesting, you know, try setting up a club of solving hard problems. One of my favorite penchants, which I always tell people, is that solving 10 simple problems of the kind that appear in most of the university exams will give you a lot of satisfaction, but no addition to knowledge. But attempting to solve 10 difficult problems and not getting a single one right will teach you more. Unfortunately, that is not acceptable. I mean, events such as one I will describe, which happened when I was a young teacher here, I think it was 72 or 73, and I used to be the coach of the chess team, and I was also a student chess player. So one of the students doing a course in late Professor Mukherjee's course on fields, electrical fields, came with that question paper of mid-sem or a quiz, I think, and he says, Fatak, how do you solve this? I looked at that problem, I could not solve it, but I haughtily told him, I am now a computer science professor. He says, don't talk rubbish, your basic degree is electrical engineering. You should still be able to answer this. We could not, so both of us went to meet Professor K.C. Mukherjee. The moment he saw us with that paper, he started smiling. He says, that question, huh? He said, yes, sir. So he just kept smiling. We then asked him, sir, what is the answer? He says, I don't know. So that student was, of course, shocked. He says, you don't know. He said, this is part of an unsolved research problem. For the last 10 years, that problem has not been solved. He says, but you know, I thought this batch was so smart that they will be able to solve the problem. So I gave it in the paper. Now, this is not the end of the story. That evening, that student went back to hostel 4 and they had a milkshake party. In IIT parlance, a milkshake party in the evening used to be arranged when something great happens for the hostel. So hostel wins a inter-hostel hockey tournament, or somebody gets a trophy in some debating competition. Something big to celebrate, you have a milkshake party. So naturally, when they were having a milkshake party, the general secretary of the hostel popped in. Arey, kya ho gaya? Mujhe pata nahi. What are you having party for? And they said, great Professor Mukherjee thinks that we can solve unsolved research problems. So we are celebrating. But you see, this is the ethos. Some of the institutions here represent that ethos at least partially. But you go to university system, there would have been a gherao to the vice chancellor. Syllabus ka bahar ka sawal pucha. Maro. You can't accept that. So the point is, in a straight-jacketed examination system, you cannot bring reforms very quickly. In fact, I doubt whether the reforms can ever be brought unless you demolish the present system of affiliation and so on. Ideally, every college should be an autonomous college, just as most of our institutions are. So we follow the tradition that if I teach a course, I set the question paper, I examine the students, and my word is final on that grading. But that does not obtain in a majority of 4,000 colleges. And hence the suggestion that while you may be required to do that, but can you not attempt something like this? So don't give an unsolved research problem as a part of the formal quiz where the marks will be counted in the university exam. But can't you do that as a weekend discussion club problem? And believe me, and this I have endorsed from at least those 67 places, because every place I asked this question and people said yes, it is possible, at least 10 to 15% of the students in these colleges will be interested in participating in such endeavors. And once that tradition builds, then who knows, slowly it may percolate down to even formal systems. The institute may start recognizing the evaluation done in such mechanisms and the performance in such cases and so on. We don't know. That is for the future. So again, the point that I would like to elaborate is that when you go back to your institutions and conduct the larger workshop, these 30, 35 teachers who will be attending the workshop, your job goes far beyond the conventional mundane task of coordinating that workshop. You are essentially the peer role model for them, and you have to help change their mindset by giving these examples of any similar examples in your own institution. You can tell them how either you or your colleagues have attempted something different, how your students are encouraged to participate in this or that or whatever, whatever, and suggest to them that they could use these mechanisms. I believe that is extremely important. Last but not the least, is the limitation of administrators. I have used a polite word for administrators, but these range from not only heads of the departments and principals or directors of the colleges, but for a large majority of these 4,000 colleges, these also include the secretaries, trustees, and the chairman of the organizations which have set up these colleges. The private-public partnership or whatever private colleges ethos essentially means that the ultimate administrative control will be in the hands of the people who are not necessarily educationists. This happens everywhere, even for us, for example. Ultimately, while we may be government-funded, it is some bureaucrats and the groups in Delhi which decides what activity we will do and what activity we will not do. But by and large, they don't enforce that you must do this. They generally say you may do this or that or not this, but the proposals still come from us. It does not happen in most of the engineering colleges. So what are their problems? What are the limitations of administrators? I divide the administrators of the private institutions in two categories. One, who have started these colleges primarily as a money-making instrument. So it's a business. They have converted engineering education into business. The law of the land says that you cannot make business out of education. Yet, it is also a fact that education must run in a business-like fashion. You cannot run an education like a dharamshala, which is what the government tried to do for the first 50 years. So if you look at all the institutions in the world, they still have to manage the financial responsibilities, even the great private institutions. For example, you take Stanford and Berkeley. Berkeley is a state-sponsored university in Bay Area. Stanford is a private university. But both have fiduciary controls which are very similar. Both are fiercely independent, although one is state-controlled, like IITs and NITs in terms of academic matters and largely in terms of financial matters. Most of these colleges are not. And that is where things start pinching. The investment that is to be done in equipment, consumables, infrastructure, etc., etc., comes in a very stingy fashion. The salaries for teachers, they are defined for government-funded institutions by the government. Teachers and students, by the way, in any society are the poorest elements of the society. I mean, that is something that all of us have come to recognize. But every time a pay commission comes, there is a step jump. And for a couple of years, everybody feels very happy till the rest of the world catches with that and goes beyond that, and then you again say, whatever. But still, we are all reconciled to it. In private institutions, even that does not happen. There are situations where people are paid a fixed remuneration. There is no scale, no promotion, whatever. There are even instances where the salary on paper is one thing, but what is paid actually is different. I thought this happened only in private schools and non-professional colleges. But it is sad to note that these things happen even in professional college. Now that is something that you and I cannot do anything about. Which means that at least for the teachers who come from such colleges, and they will be majority teachers in this country, they will also have to be prepared to work in spite of the constraints that the administrators might put in their way. And to some extent this applies to all of us. Even in IIT, there will be some administrative constraint. If I want to do something, I will have to find out rules and regulations and procedures in which I have to fit these things. Take this workshop for example. There is no equivalent of this workshop. We have continuing education program which says that you will have this workshop for teachers or QIP norms, etc., etc. But that is primarily to enhance the learning in a particular subject of all the participants. What are we doing here? We are doing nothing of that sort. We are saying we are assembled here to see how all of us together can influence other teachers. And for what purpose? For their teaching better in their colleges. So it is two stage removed. Okay. CEP has a rule that whatever course fees you charge to the students, so much percentage should go to the institute, etc., etc., etc. I had my first problem when I said course fees to be charged 0 rupees. So there is 0 rupees. I said this is funded by MHRD, you are not charging anybody. And I had a very interesting argument with one of the junior colleagues. I said, look, the teachers who are coming for the coordinator's workshop are not going to directly benefit themselves in their own career. They are coming here to do service to the larger portion of the country at our behest. Do you think if I say you pay 2000 rupees fees to come to this workshop, a single person will come? Why should he come? Or he or she? No need. Because this is you are basically going to be facilitators. So they understood that. So that means CEP does not get anything. This happened when I ran the first workshop of this kind last time for the pilot project for MHRD. So you know what I ended up doing? Because after all, it's a MHRD funded project. There is no overhead that even IIT Bombay can charge for such funding. So how can I pay anything to CEP? The via media I found out is, you see these netbook computers in front of you? I bought all of them and gave them to CEP. I said, this is the contribution of the project to continuing education program. For 3 years, we will use this whenever we run our program. Rest of the time, you use it. So then CEP coordinator noted that adequate component of the training budget has been given as overhead to CEP. Done. Now, there are no rules. You have to frame your own process, rules and things like that. The point is, all of us might be able to do that in our educational system. We have to actually train these teachers to do something similar. At one place I remember, Solapur, the engineering college I went to, said, who prevents you from keeping the lab open in the evening? This is my favorite question. Okay. Are there lights in the educational institution after the sunset? If there are no lights in your labs, there is something wrong with your institute. Because students, teachers, somebody must be working sometime in the night. Then he showed me a letter from the management which said that after the college closes, okay, all labs not only should be locked but should be sealed. Why? Because one theft of a PC hard disk had occurred 1 year ago. Now look at the response to an event and look at the objective of the activity that we do. Now such mindset, how do you break? You want to create teachers in these institutions who will take initiatives of this kind, say, all right, we'll do something. And that is where you need to facilitate. But you have to understand the limitations of the administrator. The biggest limitation is, of course, the inability or unwillingness of most of the private institutions to pay their teachers reasonably. By that I mean whatever is at least expected to be paid as per the norms of the land. But that is not happening in most places. It is in this context that I decided to do something about this, and the project proposal which was made to MHRD is based on some kind of background preparation that we have been doing at IIT Bombay. First of all, the distance education program, which is at the kernel of our activities, we started in year 2000 when I set up the School of IT. Setting up an IT business incubator and setting up the distance education program were two new initiatives which our Senate approved at that time. In fact, one person who helped me a lot in the early days along with the team, some of the team that you see here, Sami Sahasrabuddhe, who set up our entire studio and all, we'll visit our studio facilities later, is not here right now. And Professor M.U. Deshpande, who I believe currently is an advisor to Raisoni College or something. Yes. So he had just retired as the director of REC Nagpur, then VNIT now. And I asked him, so what is he planning to do? And I told him, I'm doing this exciting thing. So would he be interested? So he says, I'm an electrical engineer. So I said, doesn't matter. You are a problem solver. So solve this. He came and worked with us for almost 3 years and participated in the initial setup of this program. So what we did is, at that time, there was no ISRO EduSat. We used the HCL COMNET bandwidth, we set up the equipment, and we used this VSAT for two-way communication. We set up about 10 remote centers like that. And I already told you what happened when we tried to give our courses. People listen to those courses at remote centers, all right, but there's no adoption of that activity because of the reasons that I mentioned. However, this is the background experience that we had. We had also started recording these lectures, and then we came up with an idea of editing these lectures for release in a standard DVD or such formats, including some interactive e-learning format. So a lot of work has been done. Subsequent to this, we had a TIFAC-sponsored project on what we call e-outreach. Where we said we will hold such small workshops, 2-day, 3-day, 5-day workshops, we'll hold nutshell lectures, but whatever contents we get, we will actually release these in open source. So we even defined, I don't know what is your familiarity with Creative Commons. Creative Commons is an open source organization which goes beyond open source software. It talks about creative contents in open source. So this commons, by the way, is a traditional English word which even we use in different terminology, which says common property of a village. So for example, water bodies in a village or grazing ground for cattle would not belong to any one person. That would be considered a common property of a village. So the word commons came out of that, actually. And now, to fight against the intellectual property preservation through patents, copyrights, and so on, a large body of people which thinks that, look, at least a few things should be available to everybody. So just like the open source software movement, this was followed by the Creative Commons movement. There is a large global body. So what we did is, a colleague of mine, Professor Shishir Jha from our School of Management, he agreed to take the initiative. And we set up Creative Commons India. So Creative Commons India Center operates from IIT Bombay. He is the coordinator for it. And whatever were the Creative Commons licenses, global licenses for open source contents, we actually got them rewritten as per India specific law of the land, so that the same licenses could be used in India. And it is under that Creative Commons license by attribution. That is, whatever you want to do with the contents, you can do it, but you must attribute that the source came from such and such place. That is the license we currently use. Some of my colleagues like to use not by attribution alone, but also what they call share alike. So share alike is more like a GNU public license, where if you make any modification, you have to release that modification also in open source. There is a reason why he prefers that. He pointed out that some of the slides that we had released in open source like that were modified by someone and were being sold by that someone as slides prepared by him. So I said there may be one or two instances like that, but why clobber up everybody? we still have that debate. Whereas if our license is share alike, that means he can modify it, but he must release all of that in open source only. You can sell open source contents only for the cost of the medium. It cannot be sold for profit. So that is the essence of the. Anyway, so this e-outreach program was funded by TIFAC, the Technology Information Forecasting Council. If you recall, Dr. Rajan was the executive director once, and he is the co-author of the book Vision 2020 jointly with Dr. Abdul Kalam. Subsequently, one of my colleagues, Dr. Anand Patwardhan, was the executive director. And in fact, TIFAC approved this project. A similar project on e-learning was also approved by TIFAC at Amruta University. And that is where I first came in contact with the work at Amruta as a member of their review committee and so on. And we have been working together since. So what have we perfected in this particular project? As you can see, we are being captured. Audio video capture is being done. If there is any interaction, the interaction also gets captured. All of this can go as a single composite video, but this has to be put in multiple forms. During the lectures, there are pauses, there are changes, you want to edit them, you want to essentially make a film like a regular film where no glitches are there. That requires some editing. Additionally, if you want to put it in a format which is not in a digital captured AVI format, the AVI format will be too costly in terms of the volume. So you have to convert it at some sampling bit rate into either a CD or a DVD format. Then we are converting it into something else, like some of you might have used a tool called Producer, which comes with Microsoft PowerPoint, where you can have a video in one corner, a text of the thing in one place, and some kind of an index. Currently, we are working on an open source tool which does exactly the same thing. This kind of edited version can be very compact because the video portion is very small, and therefore this compact thing can be put as even as many as 10 or 20 lectures in a single DVD. So that is the attempt that we have been doing. Some tools have been developed. A much more sophisticated tool for a general use across wide area network of this kind, where you can actually four separate screens, etc., has been developed as a part of the Amruta efforts, which Dr. Bijlani will be explaining to us in the evening. Anyway, and we have found out how to package it. We've even worked out a method of costing. If people want these DVDs, they can send a draft of these many rupees, etc., etc. And we found that whole process was so cumbersome that nobody was interested in it. But the free download from our site, that has got an enormous response. The people are able to download freely. However, if the volumes are high and if the bandwidth, internet bandwidth, is not adequate, free download is not easily possible. I jokingly say that even today, the cheapest bandwidth in India is a train carrying full of DVDs from Bombay to Delhi. That the cost of train moving with so many DVDs, so many terabytes of data, is still the cheapest bandwidth. Otherwise, any other bandwidth is not tenable bandwidth. But we learned some of these things. We perfected the art of editing and so on. And we conducted the first pilot workshop under a joint aegis of e-outreach as well as the MHRD. By this time, MHRD was convinced that we could do this. And this brings us to the present proposal. So as part of the MHRD mission project, technical name is we conduct workshop for 1,000 teachers. But practically it is not just conducting workshop. I call it an engagement model. First of all, these workshops are conducted under the aegis of IST. While most of us in our institutions are not affected either way, but normally in the professional career, if a teacher has to move up or get increments or whatever, certain minimal norms have been prescribed by AICT. One of the norms is the number of courses or workshops that the teacher has attended. An IST workshop get some brownie points to every teacher. So just as we discussed about how, why should people pay fees and come to this workshop, we similarly say, why would the other teachers come paying fees to attend this workshop? What is in it for them? What is in it for them is essentially a certificate which carries value to some extent in their own career. So we have now, we are about to sign an MOU with IST, whereby all workshops that we conduct, this workshop and the previous pilots that we did, we have a special permission from IST, but all the other workshops that we'll conduct will have a stamp of IST. So all the workshops that we're doing are actually IST workshops. And therefore, this has some value to most of the teachers who will participate in it. But the engagement has to go beyond that. So is it only a two-week workshop? This is what we do, engagement model. The kernel of this is a two-week workshop. Incidentally, this engagement of 1,000+ teachers has to be made in 10 or 12 core subjects which are taught across the country in engineering colleges. We started with computer science because that is what is my focus area, and I could convince some of my colleagues to participate. So in December, for example, we shall have workshops on database management system, which Professor Sudarshan has agreed to conduct himself. I do not know, but I noticed that most of the places the database textbook is Kort, Silberschatz and Sudarshan. And the latest edition, actually it is mostly Sudarshan's handiwork. He has revamped the example of an American banking system and replaced it with a university example, which our people can relate to. So he will be conducting a workshop for 2 weeks in December on databases. And another colleague of mine along with me will be conducting a workshop on object-oriented programming, which is another course. After these, we will next summer and next winter and subsequent summer, we will concentrate on courses such as basic mechanical engineering, basic electrical engineering, a course which everybody feels must be done as a part of this workshop is communication skills. It is a compulsory program everywhere, whether you call it English or whatever, whatever. Surprisingly, we also have it as a compulsory course, not only at undergraduate level, but also at a postgraduate level. And not so very surprisingly, uniformly everywhere, the response of the students and the faculty of other disciplines is that that course is not adequate. Some of our students are still not able to articulate their own reports or observations properly, either in written form or in oral form. So this is a dilemma there. And particularly for students who come to first year engineering, we have noticed that this is a major problem because many of them have learnt up to 12th standard in their own native language. So you can't expect them to be fairly competent in English. So that is natural. But anyway, now in this 2 week workshop, what we do is we cover the syllabus in exactly the same way in which they are expected to teach that syllabus in their places. In the pilot workshop, we tried to do that, but the pilot workshop was a 10-day duration and not 15-day duration. And it was only to prove the point. But we did it in the same subject, so we now know, we have learned what exactly required to be done. And this workshop that we'll conduct now, we'll have about 40 lectures for those teachers, and these lectures will effectively try to cover the syllabus of computer programming as defined or as close to as defined in their own respective university. That's the reason why we have been collecting the syllabus, the exam pattern, the exam papers, etc., 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 from the teachers so that we can formulate a union of the syllabus. Do we stop there? Most certainly not. We would then like to go ahead and say that, look, while this is in general the syllabus that we cover in these institutions as well, there are a few things which are done beyond that. These could be in the form of course projects, for example, that we ask our students to do. These could be in the form of harder problems which we give in tutorials, or harder problems which we give in our exams. So these would be additional examples which will be given to them. Consequently, the model of this 2 week workshop is, there will be 4-hour lectures in the morning, which will be transmitted from IIT Bombay through our distance education mode. And for 3 hours in the afternoon, they will be conducting either lab sessions or participating in tutorial sessions, which you and your other support colleagues will be conducting at your own places. Of course, we would decide jointly what should be the experiments that they should do, what should be the lab assignments that they should do, and so on. And we'll formulate all of these well ahead of time so that you have ample opportunity to sort of set up everything accordingly. Because the kind of lab assignment that we give in IIT or the kind of lab assignment that you would be giving in your institutions may not be adequate. We still want to expose them to those kind of lab assignments, but we may also want to give some mundane lab assignments which they will have to conduct for their students. The idea is that all of this will become part of the open source contents when we release them. But the engagement does not stop here. We do not give the certificates to these teachers at the end of 2 weeks. We form teams of these teachers while they are here, while they are at your places, 3 to 4 teachers, one team, exactly like we would form students' team in a subject or a course to do course projects. And what do these teams do? They go back and solve an assignment in next 2 weeks and submit that assignment to IIT Bombay as well as to the coordinators. Only after they submit the assignment, the coordinator is supposed to release the signed IST workshop certificate to them. In fact, we had questions in our pilot. Some teachers say, we have attended 2 week program, so give us certificate. We pointed out that at the time of enrollment, we had told them that the certificate will be issued only after they complete this assignment. The assignment that I gave to the 630 teachers who came for the pilot program was to formulate questions and answers for quizzes, tests and examinations. The idea was to create a question bank which in its entirety could be released in open source. We collected, Mukta, about 1800 questions, right? 1800 questions and answers were collected. Now you can imagine this is a fairly good collection. But 1800 questions and answers have been written by these teams of 4 teachers. We found out that there were several lacunae. The wording of the question sometimes was not very clear. Sometimes the questions were too simple and straightforward. Sometimes the answers were wrong. So that means we needed to do a lot of editing of these. Now you can imagine how any one of us or even few of us, how much time we'll have to spend in editing those 1800 questions and answers. Fortunately, in IIT, we have a system of teaching assistants who are often not as much loaded in the second semester as they are loaded in the first semester. I don't know how it is in your respective place. So I got 20 TAs assigned this time, and January to April, they have edited 650 questions out of these 1800. But this is a scalable effort. Next time I can have 40 TAs assigned to this. I can afford to pay a portion of my funding as honorarium to them or something. The idea is that we should get all of this in the as perfect a form as possible, language wise, correctness wise, and so on. The second problem is, because we are releasing something in open source, we should not be rummaging on the intellectual property of somebody else. Now, if there is a published question paper, that is a published document. But as long as I can give a reference that this appeared in, let us say, Andhra University 2007 final exam, something like that. You have these guidebooks which always say this, right? That is perfectly fine. Because a question paper which has been given and published is open source. Can we say the same thing about some of the questions which are available on some sites where a teacher has set up a site in Cincinnati Bublabu and he has given some questions? And as a participating teacher, I see that question, I like it, I quote that question, I give the answer maybe, but I quote it as if it is my question. Tomorrow, if that Cincinnati Bublabu charges IIT Bombay of taking away that intellectual property, we don't know what will happen. So we are trying to build some precautionary measures by getting a certification from the participating teachers that either they have constructed this question themselves, or if they have taken it from some other source, this is the source. Now, this is not the only thing that will happen. Next time when we conduct the program, apart from the questions and answers, they will be required to do course projects, subject projects, just as we might be giving in our programming courses to our student. And there could be, say, something like 200 such projects with the project statement and the implementation available. Imagine the kind of resource, programming resource, that would be available, because all of this will become open source to both students and teachers. So that's the idea. I also did something which I would like to share with you, because I would like to extend that model. Where does this open source content go to? I mean, one is we say we release, we put it in our IIT Bombay website, but again the same problem, how many people will download, etc., etc., etc. We are doing a two-prong approach to that problem. One, we are approaching Moser Bayer, who are the DVD, CD makers of the country, saying if we give open source contents, will they help us put it in a form and will they use their distribution channel? They can charge whatever their normal distribution fees or charges or whatever, but there is no intellectual property cost for it. There is some preliminary discussion, it appears agreeable. They are the ones who are capable of making it really very low cost in the hands of people.